Paper Life Bible Church program, The Moment of Transformation. Today, by the grace of the Lord, we shall listen to our pastor, General Superintendent, Pastor W.F. Kumuyi. We are going to be blessed. It is my wish that you call your family to come and listen to you as our pastor is blessing you with his holiness message. Remain blessed.
Morning, church. It's a privilege to be with you, and I really thank God for this privilege. And I pray that the little we share together will be a blessing to you, to me, and to the whole church, and to the family of God here in Jesus' name. I'm going to share from Romans chapter 5. In Romans chapter 5, verses 17 to 21. Actually, when you think about the epistle of Paul to the Romans, it's talking about something very basic, very important, and very essential. And this has been commented on by great people like Martin Luther, like John Wesley, like quite a number of people in the church, in church history. And when you talk about salvation, about the righteousness of God, here is the major epistle where you find the apostle addressing such an important issue. And I want to talk about an essential provision of God's grace. An essential provision of God's grace. We know a lot about grace. We've heard about the grace of God, the basic verse of scripture that says, by grace are you saved, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. When you think about grace, we think about God's unmerited favor, unmerited mercy. It's not by merit we get saved, it's by the mercy of God we get saved. But sometimes we do not understand the composition of the different elements we find in that grace. Somebody has said, when you spell grace, G-R-A-C-E, it's God's riches at Christ's expense. That means the redemption of God, God's redemption at Christ's expense, and the righteousness of God being transferred or transplanted into us, all comes by the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ. So we'll say that grace simply means God's riches at Christ's expense, or God's redemption at Christ's expense, or whatever resources we need from the Lord is God's resources at Christ's expense, not by power, not by might, by my spirit, says the Lord. Everything God does for us, he does by that grace. But there is something that is missing in the church world. When we talk about grace, that's why I want to look at that essential element and that essential provision in that grace of God. Look at our text in Romans chapter 5, reading from verse 17. Romans chapter 5, verse 17, it says, for if by the trespass of one man, death reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive God's abundance provision of grace. Notice that those who receive the abundance of grace from the Lord and the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. You'll find the connection between those two things there. Number one, there's the grace of God, and it talks about the abundance of the grace of God. And then it talks about the gift of righteousness. Many people do not make that connection between the grace of God and the righteousness that he imputes and imparts into our lives. If you come to verse 18, it says, consequently, just as the result of one trespass was condemnation for all men, so also is the result of one act of righteousness was justification that brings life to all men. It says that because of the obedience of Christ, righteousness of Christ, and because of the perfect life that Jesus Christ lived, not because of him, he has now given us the redemption or the salvation which we now have through him and in him. It says in verse 19, for just as through the disobedience of one man, the many were made sinners, so also through the obedience of the one man, that's the Lord Jesus Christ, the many will be made righteous. Every time you see the mention of grace, the grace of God, not what you have done, but what he has done. And then it says, because of what he has done. Now you can have the righteousness of God, I can have the righteousness of God. The connection is very interesting, that the grace is there, then the righteousness also comes into our lives. Sometimes you find people saying, salvation is all by grace. Of course, that is true. But the interpretation of that in the minds of many people is, then I can do what I want, be what I want, or be what I don't want to be, but it doesn't really matter because it's all of grace. We're missing out something there, because when the grace of God comes into our lives, it's not empty grace. It's the grace of God that also brings righteousness along with it. In fact, it says in verse 21, it says, so that just as sin reigned in death, so also grace might reign through righteousness. So you cannot separate those two things, the grace of God and the righteousness of God. And what the Lord Jesus Christ said about marriage, we can say about righteousness and grace. It says, what God has joined together, let no man put asunder. And we want to say that God has joined grace and righteousness together. And we say, what God has joined together, the righteousness and the grace of God, or the grace of God and the righteousness, let no theologian put asunder. I think that would be acceptable. That what God has joined together, both of them, grace comes in, righteousness comes in. And the only righteousness acceptable in the sight of the Lord is that one that comes through grace. There are different kinds of righteousness you might understand, because there were some people at the time of Jesus Christ, he came with grace. In fact, the Bible says that grace and truth came through the Lord Jesus Christ. And it was that grace of God through Jesus Christ that brought the righteousness. But there were some people that could not understand when Jesus spoke about righteousness, because there is what we call evangelical righteousness. That means we preach the evangel, we preach the gospel, and it's the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, and everything that comes through that evangel or gospel, we call it evangelical. And so there is evangelical righteousness. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. That life I have, everlasting, eternal, that's evangelical. Through the evangel, through the gospel, because Jesus purchased it for me, and because Jesus provided it for me, and by faith, I stretch out my hand of faith and I receive that righteousness. It is not self-righteousness. It is not external righteousness. It is not religious righteousness. It is not righteousness of do's and don'ts. It is the righteousness coming from Christ. In fact, it says that we become the righteousness of God through him. That means there's a good transaction. There's an exchange. I give him all my sins, and he gives me his righteousness. That exchange is the evangelical righteousness we're talking about. And then there is what we call an enduring righteousness. There are some people that, you know, they come to a meeting, for example, and then they hear the gospel. I will say that if you want to give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, where you raise up your hand, and they raise up their hands, and that is great. We don't want to come up forward here. They come forward, and then they pray the sinner's prayer, and they say, praise the Lord, I am saved, because I believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And then they go away, we never find them again. We say, when the righteousness comes in, there is what you call enduring righteousness. He that believes on me. Not that I believed in the past. Am I believing today? Do I continue to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ? And that's what I'm going to examine with you. I'm going to look at number one, external righteousness. And that's what the Pharisees, the certificate, the, you know, all demonstrated about. And, you know, Jesus was talking about something great and something he brought from heaven. They say, we don't need that. We already got this. We've been in church since we were born. We've been baptized in water. We're baptized. We've done this. We've done that. And they could refer to some outward external things they have done, which they were still doing. And the Lord said, except your righteousness goes beyond that external righteousness, you will in no wise see the kingdom of God. There is something beyond what we could do by ourselves, something we could produce by human energy, something we could do by trying. I'm trying my best. I want to turn over a new leaf. You'll find when you turn over that new leaf is still as dirty as ever because it's still coming from the fig tree of Adam and Eve. You know how they sewed that together and they felt, we'll protect ourselves. Adam, where are you? I heard your voice in the garden and I hid myself. Why did you hide yourself? Because of this. Have you eaten of that fruit instead of yes or no? Well, really, you understand, this is not my fault. I was just staying like this. And then you said, I needed a wife. And then you gave me a wife. I want to announce to you, God, that woman you gave me, he made me do this. As for me, I'm all right. As for you, know, I wouldn't have done that. Were it not for that woman? And we're still in that excuse making today. And we're still telling the Lord, I'm all right, but she is not all right. I'm all right, but he is not right. All right. And were it not for the connection you made between us, I would have been as perfect as ever. And that's what the Pharisees did. Every other person was wrong, but they were right. And the Lord was saying, all that excuse making and all that external righteousness, we pack that aside and we say, we come. Nothing in my hand I bring. Simply to the cross I cling. The rock of ages cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee. And it is when we come for that which Christ has provided that we have that evangelical righteousness. And there is a word, I don't know whether you are familiar with this word. It's not the word you think. When I say guilt, you'll be thinking of G-U-I-L-T. That's the condemnation of the guilt that we have. But there's a word that is guilt. The same pronunciation, but it's G-I-L-T. And it's a kind of thing, you put on something, like gold, for example, layer that you put on something. Inside is another metal, but all you see is the gold. And that's what I talk about, number one, the guilt of external righteousness. And the Pharisees had that a lot. A beautiful exterior, a wonderful exterior, and it appeared you couldn't fault it. If you were to examine a Pharisee and you were to say, do you do this? Mark that. Yes, I do. Hi about this. Yes, I do. Hi about that. Yes, I do. This man appears all right. When you find a man that has all his righteousness well composed and put in place, but without Christ, without the cross, and without the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, and everything appears all right, but without the sacrifice and the salvation that Jesus Christ brought, we say that's just a guilt of external righteousness, a thin layer of what appears to be good, what appears to be all right, without depending upon the sacrifice and the salvation of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's see what Jesus said about those Pharisees. What I'm talking about now is the guilt, the thin layer of external righteousness. In Matthew chapter 23, here Jesus was talking to them, and these were the people that thought, we've got it all made, and we can get to heaven by ourselves, and we can walk to heaven, we can live our lives so perfectly that God will not be able to find any fault in this. He said, do this, I did. They were not looking at the motive of what they did, at the intention of what they did. They were not looking at their thoughts, at their lives, and at the love of God that should be in their hearts, because the greatest commandment is you love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And if you were to call any average person or even any kind of morally good person, have you loved the Lord with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength? The answer will be no. And yet they didn't understand that. They thought, we've got it all made. That's what Jesus Christ said. All you have is a thin layer over the corruption that is within. Matthew chapter 23, I'm reading from verse 28 there. It says in verse 28, it says, in the same way, on the outside, you appear to people as righteous. On the outside, there's this thin layer that covered everything. There's this religious kind of practice that covered everything. And I can say, I don't do this, I don't do this. By the time you are talking to some people who say they are Christians, you say, are you a Christian? Of course I am. Who do you think I am? A pagan? How do you know that you're a Christian? I don't smoke, one. I don't drink, two. I don't do this, I don't do that. I hear what you don't do, tell me what you do. They don't understand that it's not just what you don't do, how about what you do? And it's not about just what you do, what do you believe and who do you believe? Because it's a matter of believing him. Remember once again, he says, God so loved the world. And he loved you as part of that world. If you were the only sinner, the only lost person in the world, Christ would still have died for you. And you're not thinking about, you know, everybody else. You know, sometimes when we think about the world, we're thinking about that person and that person. Wait a minute. When you are hungry, although I might be hungry, but you just think of your own hunger. And when you have a problem, a pain in your, maybe your foot or somewhere, you're not thinking about all the other people in the hospitals. You are thinking about the pain you have. So when we say, when the word of God says, God so loved the world, you say, that's me, not just the whole world. That if I were the only sinful person in the whole universe, the Lord Jesus Christ would still have died on the cross of Calvary. But what have I done about that death of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary? Then it says that whosoever, and that's me, whosoever, say that's me. Oh, that's you. That whosoever believes, whosoever does not know, whosoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. We can call all the Pharisees at the time of Jesus Christ one by one and say, do you do or you believe? Their religion was a religion of do, not a religion of believing. I do this, I do this. It's not what you've done, what you've not done. It's what he has done. Instead of the two letters do, I do, I do, I do, or I don't, I don't, I don't, he's saying it is what has been done on the cross of Calvary. And because I believe that, and I believe that it was for me he died, and he rose again for my justification, that's the reason I can say I have the righteousness that is acceptable unto the Lord. But this external thing, see, Jesus said in verse 28, he said, in the same way, on the outside you appear, not that you are, but you appear to people, not to God, not to Christ, not to your conscience even, but unto people outside of you, you appear as righteous, but on the inside you are full of hypocrisy and wickedness. And that's the reason why the external righteousness alone will not cut it, will not be sufficient, and will not be acceptable in the sight of the Lord. If you look at Luke chapter 18, I'm reading this so you don't take my word for it. You don't say, he said, you'll be able to say, the word of God said that the guilt or the thin layer of so-called righteousness, external righteousness, will not do. It's going to take something deeper. It's going to take something richer. It's going to take something that is coming from Calvary to be able to get us in relationship and fellowship with God in heaven. It says in Luke chapter 18, verse 9. In verse 9, it says, to some who were confident of their own righteousness, not God's righteousness, of their own righteousness. That was their confidence. And you'll see what the man said as we read on, that the righteousness was, this is what I do and this is what I don't do. And the comparison of his life.